Here today from Lego is Bo Stjerne Thomsen. He's part of the Lego Foundation leadership team and responsible for the foundation's research and innovation agenda, supporting research partnerships, centers, and labs in many parts of the world. Welcome all, and welcome Bo.
Thank you very much, Elisabeth, and what a truly amazing atmosphere here. It's very rare to become surrounded like people, so I'm really appreciative of being here. Thank you for the invite, and great starting point for some exciting days, as I hear, like we're starting here, and I'm really grateful to invite you to also, some of you, to Billund and Lego Company in the afternoon. So I have a design background. Design, architecture, a little bit of technology, engineering, and so forth, designing everything from cities to concert halls to robotic cars, looking at lighting designs and art installations. And now I'm trying to redesign everything around me in my work. And this is really, like, this is the people I want to be with. So really grateful for being here, having discussions around design and making. So I was just reflecting, redo and 50 years anniversary of the design school fits quite well together, right? 50 years, 1967, that was kind of a redo year, right? I don't know if it's offered for Kolding that revolution started. Okay, we'll say what was called, the reason was Kolding to start the revolution in the 1960s. But actually, it's a great opportunity to redo a lot of things right now. And what I'm going to talk about is why do we do research and how truly important it is, and the Lego Foundation. What does it mean for creativity and design and play, and what could be the role, your role in that? First and foremost, this is the family behind the Lego company and all the Lego entities, which I truly owe all our great work to, because they have the values about children's creativity, imagination, curiosity, that make us able to do not only the great work in the company with the Lego materials, but also in the Lego Foundation. So these are the first three generations of the company, Ole Kirk, Gottfried, and the young boy here is Kjell Kirk Christensen, who is in our Lego Foundation board. And now the fourth generation is the chairman of the Lego Foundation board. So we are deeply committed to the values of the Lego company, which goes through the company and through the foundation. And in the middle, we have the Lego brand, as you probably all are familiar with. So the excellent quality play material with the Lego bricks, which is also available around here. And then part of the Lego group is Lego Education, which provides quality learning materials to teachers and education. But the reason for the Lego Foundation is the social impact agenda. So what we do is to support, how can we support creativity and children's ability to learn by being playfully engaged in experiences, engaging with materials, and also increasingly embedded that in educational systems. So we are very fortunate to have 25% of the Lego company to fulfill that mission, but based on the same values of the company to inspire and develop the builders of tomorrow. Our research is based on the Lego idea. So we're not only doing research on the Lego brick, actually that's a small part of it, and many of our programs and initiatives are not based on you have to use Lego bricks or Lego materials, but it's based on the Lego idea. And the Lego idea starts with Lego, which originally came back from like God, play well. The atmosphere and the experience of playing together, coming up with ideas, but also the fascinating ability of the Lego brick that you can combine things and recombine things endlessly. So you put things together, you reflect, you evaluate how it is, and then you take it apart again and rebuild into something new. Like, essentially the design processes you are all part of in your work, but we see that as critical not only for creativity and play, but also for how you learn. And actually, you know, that's a redo way of living, I would say. So redoing things all the time. You're trying to figure out how you can gradually improve and test things out and experiment and figure out how you can redesign new things. We have a challenge with our research, that generally in research, things are organized by discipline. So if I go into a university, usually I can try to find the door that is called the Department of Play, but that's not non-existing. So I can go to the Department of Psychology, the Economist, I can go to the Public Health dealing with well-being of children, but I can't find the Department of Play anywhere, and that's a bit unfortunate. So what I've been doing over the past, what we've been doing in the Lego Foundation over the past years is to build a network of partnerships to create a global network of play, learning, and creativity. That includes a long-standing collaboration with the MIT Media Lab, where I did my PhD. Almost 32 years now, the company has had this partnership with a Lego Learning Lab, professorships and research work. We have now a center, supporting a center at University of Cambridge. We are supporting a new lab at Tsinghua University in Beijing, and building relationships into how do we measure play, how do we teach play in education, how do we begin to look at parent and child relationships using play and play materials, how do we build maker studios into education with tough universities, how do we build play labs out in remote communities like in Bangladesh and East Africa, where young global leaders are educated to build and make own toys with the community, how do we look at the social emotional development of very young children in under stress and difficult circumstances. How do we experiment increasingly with new materials with Reggio Emilia and Exploratorium, which is a science center, how to design new experiences combining digital and physical. So we also have a global network called Play Futures. This is where we bring individual researchers, not only researchers in a traditional sense, but anyone who really are dedicated to systematically investigate research questions, whether you are from a practitioner background or from academic background. So Play Futures, you can go visit and you can sign in and you can join the community here. We still have this challenge of the Department of Play, but we are very fortunate this year because there is going to be like very similar to a Department of Play at the Kolding Design School, at the Design School Kolding right now. So in September, Design for Play really going to take off with this new master program. That keeps us very excited in this partnership. It's going to be developing research, innovation, the good design degree for children's playful experiences, but hopefully for everyone's playful experiences, and also with the master degree, professorships, PhD, design lab, and embracing Denmark and Scandinavia as a hub for design for play. So we're beginning to get there now, and you are really the key role model for that journey. So our aim is to redefine play and reimagine learning. Play has usually been like, go out and play, have fun, I don't care what you're doing, but just like, it's your choice what to do. Learning has been often like, only happens when you sit still on a desk in educational institutions, and what we really need is to redefine that. It's about playfulness, about experimentation, enjoyment in learning, which we feel goes quite well together, but with the purpose of talking about creative, engaged, lifelong learners. Being able to support young people, students, and adults who are able to come up with new ideas, who are ongoing motivated to learn new things and make a valuable contribution to themselves and others. And why is that important? So some of the big studies that are coming up right now in the past year clearly articulate that creativity and collaboration and critical thinking is essential. So one of the big studies around World Economic Forum, the future of jobs, 65% of jobs has not been invented yet. So children who go into school right now will end up in jobs that do not exist. You have to create your own jobs. We're not educating children or young people or students for jobs you know what are right now. You are being educated to create your own job. Education 2030, the long-term milestone for what are the key skills, talks about creativity, critical thinking, and collaboration. And of course, there is a foundation in some knowledge, but the key competences right now is creativity, critical thinking, and collaboration. And that's the UN entities that talks about that right now. In policy change, it's really transforming right now. This is just one example from Australia, where the whole education systems are now being rethought in terms of how to prepare young people for the future. It talks about the Pearson institutions, talks about schools preparing for dynamic places to learn. MIT talks about whiplash. So our partner at MIT, how technologies penetrate any place we work and live, and basically feels like a whiplash, like being hit driving on the highway with 100 miles per hour and just being hit by a truck, because everything with technology radically changed how we think and feel right now. But there are also good news. So things like PISA testing, which we are not very fond of, usually standardizing children's abilities, actually now has a measure of well-being. And that measure of well-being actually says that if you are interested, engaged, motivated to achieve, you also do better academically. So we see the strong relationship between being creatively, expressing yourself, and doing well academically. So there's a big call out now for creativity. And this is a recent study we did with the Brookings Institution, the global think tank. If you look at the government and policies worldwide right now, which is an open source document, the key thing governments worldwide talk about right now is creativity, critical thinking, communication, and problem solving. And you can go on that website and you can add to the documents. But it means not only in the mission and statements, in the skills identified, but how they embedded in curriculums in China, to Denmark, to Zambia, to Kyrgyzstan, south of Russia. There's a movement towards thinking about creativity and critical thinking as the key thing to look into. Globally, what's the state of creativity? This is a global study just back from December. More than 5,000 people asked across 5 countries above 18 plus. Creativity is valuable to society and the economy, believes 70% of people. Being more creative makes people better workers, leaders, parents, students, believe 70% of people. And even in education right now, if you ask students and teachers, the most effective ways of learning are through doing things and creating things. Doing and creating for me is not the same, but at least we get to doing, and then we can come to creating and designing things, which should be the most important ways for children and to learn and young people to learn. And even students know that they have to invent their own jobs. 83%, sorry, it's small, we can get the slides later. 83% of students know they have to invent their own jobs, and teachers know, 94% of teachers know that they are educating now young people for jobs they don't know what are. So that's a great opportunity. So that's opportunity to play. So now we're going to play a little bit. So on your chairs, there's a little bag of Lego bricks. And you have a small activity to engage you a little bit. If you take that little bag of bricks and you open it, you have 60 seconds to build a Lego duck. A duck. So open the bag and build a duck. And I'm already getting busy here. I'm counting the clock here. Starting it. Oh, there's plenty of time. Still 30 seconds left. Voila, some people already finished. There are some expert Lego builders in here. Oh, there's still 20 seconds left. So now, if you have time left, you can adapt it, you can change it, you can redo it with 10 seconds left. 5, 4, 3, 2, and that's it. Can you look at your duck? Look at it yourself, and then hold it up so everyone else can see it. And then look at your neighbor ducks. I think I'm going to do a duck picture. Maybe that would be go on the website. Yeah. So this is how we think designing an education should look like. Like, when we learn and when we are part of being educated, it's diversity to embrace. It's a diversity of ideas and expressions that come up. So we're not educating young people to be the same, but to be very different. So, but with the same kind of materials, just 6 bricks in this case, we're actually able to come up with great variety of different Lego ducks. And usually if you have conferences of several hundred people like this, there's not one that is the same. If you look across, you can compare later and talk about the story of your duck, they actually look quite different. And this is what we can even measure now. Like, we can think about the originality, the flexibility that I embed in this. But even more important, what we are really interested in, what are the abilities and skills you're using when you build and make things? So usually you say, well, we are building and making things and designing things to come up with a great product to serve the needs of so a user or provide a value for society, but actually the process of making things is deeply related to how we learn. So these are some of the characteristics, the skills you're using when you're building and making things. You're keeping attention, you're using executive functioning. So in just 60 seconds, you are clearly focused on the task, not listening to your neighbors, just getting this done, which is key for anyone to learn or problem solve or do things in the work. Self-regulation, just these 60 seconds, you are thinking, oh, I can't do a doc, that is impossible, like 60 seconds. But actually you are regulating yourself emotionally and say, of course I can do a doc, I can do it, let me try. You're doing about symbolic representations, so like when you're designing things, you're trying to figure out what is the meaning of these elements. Like this little red piece here, which could be the wings or the beat or the feet. So you're always making judgments about what is this, the meaning of this object, what is the symbol that I can use to communicate what I'm doing. And this is a key predictor of language abilities of children. Spatial abilities, so you're moving things around, you're rotating objects, you're trying to sort and quantify things. This is a predictor of mathematics. So when you create and make things, you're naturally exploring materials, sorting, quantifying, textures and so forth, which is related to mathematics and careers, not only in engineering, but also in performance arts and so forth. And flexibility, so you could change a dog, like now the tail becomes a wing, or the wings becomes a feet. So that ability to switch between different ideas is what you're using when you are creative and imagining new alternatives and so forth. So our critical argument here is that usually we say that playing and making things is just for fun, right? You enjoy what you do, it provides a value for someone, but the process of it, that's the most interesting. That's where you learn the most. That's where you get familiar with materials and ideas, and that's what we want to embrace. So, now we're coming to a point that is quite different from any time else. If you look 5 million years back, this is human evolution, evolutionary psychology. There's a direct relationship, some people think, I wasn't here 5 million years ago, but in evolutionary psychology, relationship between the objects we have, the things we make, and how our brains have evolved. So if you look at the different objects that our ancestors used and what they did and how they were thinking, you know, they had stone axes 2-3 million years ago with Homo habilis, the handyman was called. You had beginning to develop symbols and signs with the Homo erectus that was standing on legs, which is a starting point for communication. You began to have writing abilities and the Gutenberg press with the Homo sapiens just very recently, 100,000 years ago. But the objects you produce is related to how you think. Your brains is related to how you use your hands and what you make. And that's very important because the new technologies that we are getting our hands into and our ability to offload information into our environments, into our phones, into big data or internet and so forth means that we have to reconsider our education completely from scratch at the axiomatic level, like the meaning of education. It's not about producing and getting knowledge. It's about figuring out what do we do with all these excellent new materials that are coming up from the Lego bricks, the symbolic representational abilities of combining, recombining ideas to increasingly embedded sensor systems, which we have in the Lego bricks right now with redo and mindstorms, allows you to do motors and sensors and proximity and so forth. And then increasingly into papers and into Play-Doh and into textiles. So the technologies are getting embedded into our environments means we have to think differently, not only when we design it, but when we use them. And our minds are different, are used for different things. So there's a twist right now. So we are going from knowing to playing. So John Seely Brown looked at this and said, so John Seely Brown was the inventor of one of the great technologies back in 1960s, chief technology officer of Xerox. And he said, well, we come from the Homo sapiens, the man, and I'm sorry about not being gender neutral here, the human who knows, to the human who makes, to the human who plays. And that's a different. Like, it's not about the knowledge you have, it's not only about the things you make, but it's how you experiment and play and share with others. This is a starting point for culture. And people can talk about Homoludians and that work that was started, I think, back in the 1930s. But the relationship between these elements is critical because this is based on your initiative. What do you want to know? What do you want to make? how do you play and experiment and create things with other people? And this is a starting point from how the design education should look like, and this is how we are learning in a world of constant change. So, the really good news, play made the modern world. So, people tend to think that, you know, when we design things and come up with ideas, it's out of necessity. Someone has a need, someone has a value unfulfilled, which is honestly also true to some degree, but if you look into where great ideas come from. So Stephen Johnson was visiting us a few weeks back in Billund, and he said actually the most transformative ideas and technologies like the computer did not emerge out of necessity, but from the strange delight of tinkering and play, for the love of doing it. Because I loved exploring that. I loved taking things apart. I loved designing things. It's interesting. It's meaningful. And that's how the greatest inventions came up. So, new type of objects, new design technologies we are being invented which change how we think, but also the process of doing that is radically changing. So, we are studying that in the LEGO Foundation. This is a recent leaflet that we just published a few weeks ago. So we're looking into the neuroscience of how one learns and what makes us creative. And there'll be white papers coming out right now in the next month on the neuroscience behind play, the skills we developed, how parents can support it, and later also how teachers can support it. But it's when activities are joyful. It sparks the reward system. You are easily able to recode information. It's when things are meaningful. You can connect to something that's valuable. You are actually engaged and fully absorbed. You are allowed to experiment and try things out. It's not about repetition. It's about trying things and then doing a little bit different and trying it again. And it's about socially interactive by sharing ideas and getting feedback. And if you look into these qualities that are built among young children and sustained until adults, these are the ones that make us successful adults. So what we're interested in, what are the studies that looked into, what are the experiences of children, young people, that makes adults successful? What are the systems to build here? So just one, a few examples here. So when children are exploring things, are curious, are moving around at the age of 1 and 4 on the left side, these are the children who have higher academic and higher intellectual abilities. Because curiosity drives your access to information and your ability to always understand, explore, and consider, and quantify, and sort, and so forth. And the diagram here is not to say we only need to sustain that in childhood. Actually, you have to keep doing that. Keep exploring things. Keep being curious. Keep moving around and trying things. Because your ability to pretend and imagine things that do not exist is related to your ability to come up with ideas later in life. So the children and young people who keep coming up with new ideas and alternatives are the ones who keep doing that as adults, but also are better able to cope with difficulties. So if you're in a really, really difficult situation as an individual or as a family or in your work, you use your imagination to think about alternatives. So imagination is thinking back and forth in time, thinking about other ways of doing things, and we often think, generate a new product or a new invention, but you also generate a better sense of yourself and how you can adapt things. So these are studies that look at that relationship, being open to new experiences, correlate with achievement in arts and science, early experiences of testing things out, not stopping after failure, made Sir Warren Buffett, the Bill Gates, the Michael Dell. These were the successful entrepreneurs because in their early life, as young people, adolescents, they were testing things out, they were not stopping after failure, and they were going ahead with persistence, determination, and motivation. And lastly, it's all social. So this last one is a study following children from 25 years. If you look into a kindergarten space, and you look among the children of the ones who share ideas and things, who are helpful to others, listen to others and give each other feedback, and find them back in the mid-20s, the ones who did that have higher education and better able to maintain full-time jobs. It's a process of collaborating, giving feedback, helping each other make successful people. So, creativity is so important. What is the role of education? So these are the last few examples of what we think is important and what we are doing. I can highly recommend the report from 2013, The Avalanche is Coming. It's not to make a dreadful scenario here, but think about a snow-covered mountainside that looks solid, but everything is being slowly eroded because global economy is changing, cost of higher education is increasing, value of a degree is falling, content is becoming ubiquitous, and competition is heating up. There's a completely new competitive landscape out there for higher education and lifelong learning distributors of different kinds of content, and people can define what kind of university you want to be. Elite, mass, niche, local, or lifelong, we need a creative, engaged, lifelong university. We need someone who embraces creativity and design and making things from the early years, continuously taking responsibility of providing alumni and support for also adults in the workplace. So this is a great starting point, inspiration for how and what can be done. And what we tend to look at in the last two examples here, so when we're building the lifelong learning lab at Tsinghua University, the aim is to support an educational reform in China. That's a partnership, because that's what's needed. Everyone wants the creativity and critical thinking, collaboration. It's a how we're going to do it that is a key question right now. But we need a creative learning environment across ages and disciplines focused on these new skills. We need to have new tools that support creative engagement. We need to study how they engage children and young people, and we need to convene decision makers. So what we do is support crazy installations like this. This is an atomic force microscope. It allows for $200 using a Lego Mindstorms robot, children to look into atomic scale and being distributed across China so children can be engaged in science in very hands-on ways. And now they use it to study pollution in Beijing because they've figured out that taking pollution on a little plate, putting on the microscope, and using a little software program they invented, they can look at very valuable, meaningful data in the environment. And we want to figure out then how are young people engaged in that process in higher education, and how can we present it to the ones who really need to think about the educational system. So this is the previous Prime Minister of Denmark, and we have ongoing conferences around creativity in China. And similar in the MIT Media Lab, the main aim is to develop new technologies and strategies for cultivating creative learning and playful experimentation. Or, in short, let 1,000 weirdos bloom. That's what we should get out of education, right? The creative ideas, the experimentation, the collaborators, right? We need thought leadership. We need digital expertise. We need networks and connections. So we need leaders who can go in there, meet the chief technology officers and the Obama, and talk about what really needs to drive education right now. What are the new kinds of technologies we can invent to engage young people and build a network of like-minded people who want to explore that together with us. So, Kolding Design School, excellent place to start, and we are looking forward to that journey because you are the role models. You are the pull. Some people say, you know, it's the jobs who is the endpoint. It's not the jobs who is the endpoint. It's lifelong learning, being motivated to learn, and the universities is a role model in the pull all the way down the educational systems. And we see that everywhere in the world right now. Everyone wants to go to the MIT, Tsinghua, they want to go to the great institutions, they want to have great grades, because that's the admission criteria. No, it's not. Like the design school here, it's your portfolio, it's your experiences and projects, and that's interesting. So go out, create some great jobs and young people who can change the world. Thank you.